Ben Folds is the lead singer of one of the more innovative rock bands today, Ben Folds 5, formed in 1994 in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. The band is really only a trio and consists of a piano, a drummer, and a bass player, unheard of in today's world of guitar-driven rock music. Their song, Brick, became the sleeper hit of 1997. It launched a multi-platinum selling album, Whatever and Ever, Amen. Their latest CD is the Unauthorized Biography of Reinhold Messner. Here is a clip.
Well, I thought about the army. Dad said, son, you must be high. And I thought, yeah, there's a first for everything. So I took my old man's advice, three sad semesters. It was only 15 grand. Spent in bed, I thought about the army. I dropped out and joined a band instead.
Welcome to the broadcast.
Thanks.
It's great to have you here.
Good to be here.
Fellow North Carolinian.
Yep.
Trace for us this sort of evolution to this sort of huge reputation you have now.
Which reputation is that?
Well, it's just that you much talked about. I mean, you know, yeah. I can give you some quotes that are really interesting in terms of what magazines say. For example, Spin magazine on Reinhold Messner, the pretense of wild and crazy crackers banging away without a guitar has mostly disappeared, save the lead singer, Army, and Redneck Past. It goes on and on and on. And just Newsweek, the suavest, most ambitious Neil Lounge album ever, as if we needed that.
I thought you meant my reputation as a Golden Gloves boxer.
No, I didn't. Okay.
We started in 94, and... The premise was going to be a band with no guitar and just piano, bass, and drums, and that we would, kind of be forced to, put out a little more energy to make the thing rock. And I also, I've heard so much guitar, and I love guitar, and I love guitar players, but nothing excites me about playing in a band that way.
Yeah.
And Robert and Darren, we met at that time, and things happened pretty fast. We played local clubs. Never made a demo tape. Say, but we did a single, and that got us a record situation with Caroline Records, and we put out an album. I think we spent about $3,000, $5,000 on the album. Subsequently, we ended up spending probably about $250,000 on videos for the album, but the album was really cheap.
$3,000 on the album, $250,000 on videos.
I think it's something like that, yeah.
Do you have to make it in your business? What do you have to do?
We had to be successful in a short period of time because we were carrying a grand piano or a baby grand piano with us.
Yeah,
I mean,
and that's not cheap.
We didn't have money. We were everyone was working day jobs, and we borrowed money for a van. We borrowed money for a piano, which was always kind of like this thing's going to get repossessed any day. Throw the piano in the van, and the three of us rolled it in ourselves. Into the clubs.
Did you get immediately characterized as sort of the piano band?
Yeah, that was a reputation that happened, I think, pretty quickly because we were just out there playing. It wasn't like making tapes and sending them out and going, listen to us. It was just showing up at basically like indie rock and punk clubs and playing what we did in the context of what was going on today rather than it being like here's an old jazz thing or a throwback or... Or we're going to play theaters and be, highbrow about it. We just went in and sweated it out in the clubs, and I think that's what made it real.
Just out there doing it and growing as you're playing.
Doing it for kids.
Yeah.
When I mean kids, I mean people under 20 years old, as opposed to going out and saying, because at first everyone wanted to book us into, like, blues bars and stuff, and we were really opposed to going in and playing something for an older crowd who's going to go, oh yeah, I remember back in the day, Jerry Lee Lewis you guys are like this, something old. Instead, we're playing for people who haven't heard that stuff before, and we're developing something that means something to them and to us,
yeah.
And it's a newer thing that way.
The notion of where you want to go, where is it?
I'd like to be asked to go up on one of the shuttle missions.
Really?
Yeah.
And bring a little North Carolina.
Yeah. I'm going to go up there with a little toy piano.
But where does it? Where does this go in the next, where will you be different today than you are, say, than you will be 2-3 years from now?
Well, it's hard to tell about 2-3 years, but immediately I feel like, I feel a responsibility, that might sound kind of funny, to make a truly pop record,
to really just... To go all out for commercial success?
Not in like a cheesy way at all. On our own terms, things that are just hooks and fun and mean something. And we're very dense about our music. Yeah. Like, well, we're very dense personally.
Well, I see.
But the music is very thick, and there's a lot of things going on, and I think that's one reason a lot of people like us. And at the same time, a lot of what's going on is very hooky, and we tend to sabotage, I think to a certain extent, the commercial potential of a song by thickening it up with lots of subtext, lots of harmonies, lots of stuff going on. So I kind of feel like, you know, choosing broader themes on the next record.
Less is more somehow?
Yeah, and it's just, you know, not as a policy, really, but just I'm really dying to do it. Like when we're playing shows, I'm really wanting to. I'm having these ideas that are very simple, and I think that we're going to do an album like that next, and probably be stripped down more to the piano, bass, and the drums again.
Yeah. So you won't expand the band?
Not on this one, I don't think.
Yeah. But down the road?
Down the road, it's possible. I can see you doing just about anything. whatever keeps you entertained, because we've got a really good rapport with an audience of people who are a lot like us. And
what does that mean?
I just look out in the crowd and I just see a bunch of me 10 years ago.
Really?
Basically, you know, they're like, I don't, you know, they know they can't be Marilyn Manson, or they don't want to be, or it's, they're just their eccentricity is not, you know, worn on their sleeve. They're not like out.
But I would assume, based on everything you've said to me, that there's nobody out there you want to be either.
No, I just want to do what I do and do it well, and hope that I've got the, you know, the guts to kind of stand by it when it's not that cool.
So if it loses some appeal and you believe in it, you want to have the courage to keep it.
Just keep it up. And I think that's, this album is that to a certain extent. It's not an overt attempt to bring in this big audience. It's very much what we wanted to do. Right. And I was actually relieved when we started playing the songs to see that our audience was following and they were into it.
Who's influenced you the most? I mean, what musicians do you really connect with?
I like Randy Newman a lot. And I like, have you heard Elliott Smith? He's my age, and he's a songwriter, and he's very inspired.
From North Carolina?
No, he's from, I think Elliot's from Texas originally, but he came up in Portland, Oregon, and he's just got, there's something in his music that's hasn't happened before. I don't know, he's a really interesting songwriter. And there's a lot of electronica out there, too, I mean, that's that I think is just amazing. I mean, Fatboy Slim is great, and all the ones that you've heard of, Chemical Brothers, Prodigy, and Propeller Heads, and Orbital, all those bands, I love them. Because they're doing something that the shit has not been done before. You know, it's brand new. Mm-hmm.
This album is called Reinhold Messner, Ben Folds 5. Thank you for coming.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us. See you next time.